Have you experienced a PDO thread dimpling or puckering? Let's talk about it and some solutions today. Okay, so PDO threads, they're all the rage. How do I know? On the YouTube channel, and when we follow the metrics, everyone wants to watch videos on PDO threads. They want to watch them being put in. They want to watch before and afters. And clinics love doing the procedure. There's a couple of issues. Not everything comes without its problems. And the more results you get with procedures in general, the more side effects you can get. It's not surgery, but it's somewhat microsurgery because we're placing long cannulas along facial tracts, along certain planes and vectors to lift and readjust the tissue. Now, we're talking about dimpling today and puckering, and that's really only occurring with barbed threads. There are exceptions, and there are smooth threads that can cause them, especially around concentric muscles, like maybe an eye or around the mouth. If you stop the thread in the lip too prematurely, or you inject it too far in, when the mouth contracts, you're creating a smaller area. If the thread is robust, you can sometimes see a little dimpling or a puckering, or maybe with that concentric movement, the thread wants to come out. But in general here, we're talking about barbed threads. And while I'm talking on this subject, let's clarify. I'm talking about PDO threads, same pretty much applies to PCL and PLLA threads, but most people are using PDO because they're dissolvable sutures. I say that because some of the older threads were permanent. They did cause puckering, but that's a permanent problem. Often they had to be removed. Satisfaction with those was around 50%. Some countries you'll still find them. Here in the United States, they've been taken off the market. But PDO threads, we're referring to dissolvable sutures. So by nature, this problem is often short-lived. But the issue is this. We're getting larger and larger barbs, and we're getting more and more lift, and people putting more in to try and approximate a facelift, which this is not. It's part of a non or minimally invasive rejuvenation procedure, lifting procedure, if you want to say, but it's not a facelift. And if people come in and they need a facelift, that's what they should get. And so we're talking PDO threads, they are dissolvable. We are talking about mainly the ones that have barbs, but they need to be put in the right patient at the right depth. And the number one thing to do to avoid this altogether is get training to put the threads in properly and to prevent what you can. Then a couple things you can do off the bat to prevent it. Make sure you place it deep enough and you're watching, and there's a method. This isn't to teach how to do it, but understand they should be at the right depth. Too superficial. Too deep, of course, is bad. Too superficial, we don't want that either. And before cutting the thread, one of the most important things we do now that we didn't do 6 years ago is have the patient animate. And you can even leave all the threads in, which is what I do, until the very end, get them to animate, sit them up, get them to move, talk, express. And if there's any irregularity, unzip it at that time. Now, a caveat here, once again, we're stepping our threads up to molded threads. A little more difficult to unzip these, but still possible. I guess we should also talk about where you get your threads from. This problem of puckering, dimpling, irregularity, superficial threads, we used to see it in the earlier threads we had. As the threads have evolved and changed, there's much that goes into the engineering, including how the thread comes out of the cannula, the tensile strength, how it breaks down, and the size. So if you're getting your threads from a reputable source and they have a medical director who deals with the issues, you have a lot backing you up. If you're getting your threads from other sources, unknown sources, and you don't know what they are, if they're sterile, because people will call me all the time or text me and say, hey, Rajani, can you help me with this puckering of a thread? Or I've had a patient with a thread complication, what can I do? The first thing I ask is, where'd you get the threads? What are they made of? What size thread? So for patients, no one can answer the question for you except your provider, because they know all those things. So what do you do when you get it? Okay, because no matter what, and someone I think was a little offended on Instagram because they said, hey, I've never had a complication from fillers. And I said, well, you haven't done enough fillers. And we mean that honestly. I mean, I've been doing this over 20 years, and we didn't know a lot about complications in the early days, so we were all collaborating on this. And we just accepted that if you do this long enough, if you see enough patients, you're going to get complications. It's not if, it's when. If you don't have great techniques, you're going to get more complications, granted. But if someone's never had a complication, and if you've never had a puckering or an irregularity, you're probably not doing a lot of threads, because the literature documents about 18% puckering. And even though that's in the literature, often I cut that in half or to a quarter, because a lot of people, especially if they've had proper training, you can reduce that most complications by 70 or 80% from what the literature says many times, if you're careful, if you choose your patients correctly, and you stay up on your training, and you're judicious in the use of all these things. So that would be one thing to consider, what type of thread and how, what you do. But let's just assume that it's a PDO, PLLA, PCL, resorbable thread. First, prevent it. Second thing, what I do, is you could do nothing. If it's minimal, if it's early in the game, if it's only visible with extreme expressions, this is going to get better. Tincture of time is on your side, and it will always get better because PDO absorbs. It usually will soften, and this problem goes away by 1 to 2 months. If it's really superficial, really the thread's in there 4 to 6 months, but typically this puckering will last 1 to 3 months. Now, people don't like it. It gives anxiety for the practitioner to have someone out there who's not happy with their work. None of us like that. And people are focused on it, so they think that everyone can see that irregularity, even though it might be minor. So you might have to act on it. What do you do? Number two thing, I use radio frequency. I like my Viora device for this. You can use the ST, bipolar radio frequency. I tend to like, normally where you're gonna see this problem is the lower face, at the edge of the mouth, trying to lift the edge of the mouth, sometimes at the jawline, but in general down here with the FC, it is suction and radio frequency, and you can heat and suck the skin in an upward manner, and I think it unzips it a little bit, it heats it, it softens the thread a little bit, but it's always worked for me. And so I'm thankful for that. I've never had to remove a thread, but I'm ready to, and I expect I will. It can happen at any time, it can happen to anybody. So, but radio frequency, that's always worked for me. It might not, and certainly I've had people come to me that have had threads put in that we had to act on, but usually when they come to another provider to get it, they've already waited a month or two and they're kind of at the end of the rope. So what do you do? The third thing, I would say the next thing and the most minimally invasive is to take a micro cannula. You could use a 27 gauge in this case, 25, 22, because you're not injecting anything. You're simply using it to undermine around the thread to loosen it up. And by doing that, if it's a deeper pucker, this often will get rid of the problem. And it's minimally invasive, it's a blunt cannula. You can get some swelling from that procedure, granted, but a little bit of swelling then goes away. You can even infiltrate a little bit of water around it. Now this brings me to, I think we're at our fourth or so, which is hydration. And there's people writing articles on this now. I'm doing some tests in my clinic here. I have threads in different test tubes to see how quick they're dissolving, what the pH could be. And what the idea is, inject through the cannula something that's going to hydrate the area. And I'll know more on this as I learn more in my own clinic, my testing area, to see what's dissolving these threads the quickest. And I met someone from Central America when I was at a conference there a month and a half ago, and I know he's working on it. So an actual dissolver for this stuff. So we'll see, that could be interesting. But you can add fluid around the area and that can work very well too, along with undermining it. Now we go to number five, where we're gonna remove it. So I think there's two ways to do it. The easiest way, what most people have in their clinic, take an 18 gauge needle, you make an opening, and when you make the opening close enough to the thread, you can take a pair of forceps and you can just tease that thread out. And by doing that, you can grab it with your hand or then the forceps and pull. That can hurt a little bit depending if the thread is fairly new in the patient, the barbs are still strong. When you pull, there'll be some discomfort, but it will come out. The molded threads are gonna be a different animal, and that's why we say you should probably be using regular threads, regular barb threads, for a year or 400 or so patients before going to the molded, because they're not gonna pull out that easy. And the barbs aren't going to degrade, the molds aren't going to degrade as quick as the barbs. So you might consider sticking with barbs until you're really sure of your technique. The other thing to do is a Wagner Medical hook. It's a little hook from Wagner Medical. I have one, never had to use it, but when you have something, you may never need to use it. When you have that insurance policy, you hope you never need it. But it's got a little hook on it, and you can go in with the 18 gauge needle, make an opening, grab it with that hook, and it will bring the thread to the surface and you could remove it. So those are some ideas. It's not all inclusive. I'm going to run through other PDO thread complications over the next couple of months. There's bruising, you can ding the nerve a little bit, so you get a slight nerve palsy, we'll talk about that. Hematomas, we'll talk about other ones individually. I wanted to cover puckering first. It's the most annoying. It's what the most people are going to call back for that you may need to act on in some way. What do you do? Have you seen it with certain threads and not others? What do you do to get rid of it? And what techniques do you use? We're all learning here. It's an educational channel. Love to hear from you. Join us on Instagram. We talk about these things over there. Subscribe here. Become part of our family on YouTube. And stay tuned. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.